find somebody. But you didn't get somebody to hug who you didn't come here with. Find somebody who didn't come here with. Tell them good morning. And after you do that, if you physically got your place, stay standing.
You see,
there you go.
Mommy up there.
There you go. How many of you was sleeping real good and your bed was real warm? Yeah. But now we're in the Lord's house and He has blessed us to be able to come here. So here's what I'd like for us to do this morning, which is just a little bit different. I'm going to ask you to, if you got somebody next to you, grab their hand. And we're going to pray individually this morning for just a few moments, because if you're anything like me, your week gets to moving around. Sometimes you wake up, you roll out of bed, you say thank you, Lord, and then you off into your day. You check that little box. I say good morning, Jesus, and boom. But I think there are times where God really just wants to hear from us. Because when people love you and you love them, you want to hear from them. So I want us to just take a few moments for those of you who've got busy schedules and whose planners are full with task items and goals and objectives. I want you to just bow your heads for a moment this morning and just talk to the Lord. Just take a few moments wherever you are. Talk to Him about what's going on in your world. Talk to Him about what's happening in your life. I let you in on a little secret, it's okay to tell him. Like, he knows, but he wants to hear. He's the one person you don't have to cover up with and wonder if he can handle what it is you have to say. He can handle it. 60 more seconds of that. Just talk to him. Life this morning. Thank you for breathing on us this morning. Thank you for caring for us. Thank you for your grace toward us. Thank you for always being there when no one else may be there. Thank you for providing when we didn't know how it was going to come. Thank you, Lord, for healing and for bringing us to a place where we didn't think we could get to in life. Thank you, Lord, for keeping us. Thank you for guiding us, even when it doesn't make sense or we don't totally understand what you're doing. Thank you for your hand being on us. God, thank you for everyone in this sanctuary. Lord, we all come with challenges. We all come with issues. We all come with concerns, but you are Lord of them all. So there is nothing that we can't tell you or cast at your feet, because we know that you are more than able to handle it. God, you can do things that we can't even seem to imagine and or think. And so, God, help us to have the right view of you, which is much larger than sometimes we see you. And God, may you just take over this worship experience, and may we surrender our lives and our worship to you this morning and celebrate you just because of who you are, not for stuff, not for titles, not for what you've given us, just because of who you are. We say that today. We cry that out today. In Jesus' name we pray. Let us all say together. Amen. Can we put our hands together real good? I'm going to ask you to make you come up this morning. And I'm going to ask you, if you can, sing. Now look, here's the beauty. When you sit out here, you can sing whatever note you want to. So whatever sounds good to you, That's what you sing. Sing it loud, sing it low, sing it in between, sing it however you want to sing it, all right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. All right.
Praise the Lord, everybody.
Praise the Lord.
This is the day that the Lord has made. Why don't you rejoice just for a minute and be glad in it? I was glad when they said unto me, let us go into the house of the Lord. Oh, magnify the Lord with me and let us exalt his name together. Come on, anybody come to do it? Just give him a hand clap of praise as we wait for the track to start.
Amen.
Give us some volume, Brother Keith. Yes.
Clap
along
with us.
Yay, my God reigns,
my God reigns,
our God reigns,
our God reigns.
Lord, you reign above every name.
Say, my God reigns.
Above every
Aren't you glad church got jokes? So there was a tweak between rehearsal and today to take that song out. I don't think anybody read it. But I thank you for being ready, right? I was ready,
bro. I'm glad you was ready.
Here's what I'm going to ask those of you who are sitting. I'm going to ask you to stand. We're going to serve communion in between music. Here's why. For those of you who were here last week, we started talking about the true meaning of Christmas being centered on Jesus. And how many of you have already done some Christmas shopping? It's okay. You have that? Okay, how many of you have done some online shopping? And so if we're not careful, it's real easy to just keep going through Christmas and be here, and then we'll throw Jesus in on the end. Like, oh yeah, this is about Jesus. Merry Christmas. But I want us to take communion today to center and bring remembrance to our minds of just who he is. So I'm going to ask if, now, this is me, and my help has left. But I, there's always a round bush. So keep coming. Now here's what I want you to do. You're going to get on the job training. And get the communion right. And the house of the Lord. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Now here's what I want you to do. I want you to stand next to me and repeat up. No. We're going to pray and then we're going to serve you. How about that? Is that all right?
Amen.
All right. Let's pray. Father, we thank you that we get to do this. We thank you that we get to serve you. God, we ask that you take what we're about to take, Lord, and turn it from a corner use to a spiritual use. But most of all, may you prepare our hearts for it, that we may remember the work that our Savior did on the cross to save us. Not only to save us, but to restore us and redeem us. May we do this all together and celebrate the fact that there's no further work that has to be done, that Jesus has done and paid it all just for us. It's in his name we pray. Amen. So here's what I want you to do. I want you to make sure you serve them first, and then just go row by row. I think you can handle that. I think you got it. I think you got it. And I'm going to ask that you hold that until all of us have. Says this. It says that the disciples were in the room and Jesus was trying to explain to him about his departure. But because of what he was explaining wasn't necessarily what they wanted to hear or grasp, they were pushing back on him. And some were even asking questions like, who's going to be the greatest in your kingdom? And Jesus was trying to teach them that greatness comes through serving, not through titles, not through who you are, the possessions you own. And so he sat them down for a meal and said to them that I'm going to take this meal with you, but there's an aspect of it I won't do again until we do it together in my Father's kingdom. So just like any of us, when someone is giving you what's getting ready to happen without giving you all the details, it makes you nervous. How many of you are detailed people? Yeah, you want to know the details. And when someone leaves a detail out, how many of you don't have a problem with asking questions? But they didn't get a chance to ask questions. They just had to accept what he had to say, which further heightened their curiosity, their nervousness, and their fear, because they had been walking with Jesus for a little bit over 3 years, and now he was talking about leaving them in a hostile environment, in a world that did not care about them or him. And so, with that, he serves them communion to let them know that even though I might not be physically present with you, I will always be with you spiritually. So on that night, he took the cup, and after giving thanks, he said to them, "This cup represents my blood, which will be shed for many for the remission of their sins. But I won't drink this again with you till I drink it with you in my Father's kingdom." And pass it around. They all did drink. Let us drink together. Now, they had a place to go out and fellowship to. But even in going out to fellowship, they still had not grasped fully what Jesus was talking about. So since we fellowshiped earlier this morning, I'm not going to ask you to necessarily go far away fellowship. I'm just going to ask you to get with the person next to you and say to them, "I'm glad Jesus did what he did. Sometimes when we sing, we worry about who's looking. If Jesus has been excellent to you, I don't want you to worry about who's looking at you. Because I'm sure when he blessed you, you didn't care about who was looking at you. So today, I want you to just open up and be free and worship him. Amen?
Amen.
All right.
Oh Lord, how
Children's Church. Children's Church.
As you stand, if you will turn to your Bible to Luke chapter 1. As you stand, as you get there, I'm going to ask my wife to come up, if you don't mind, and I'm going to ask her to squat, so that I squat, I'm going to squat. Now, squat, I'm going to need you to do me a favor. Give her a head start. Wait. Thank you. Another adjustment had to be made last minute. So we're going to get into this. Luke chapter 1, starting at verse 39. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to pick up from last week as we were talking about the true meaning of Christmas. And we watched, if you weren't here last week, you can go online and click it. We watched this video from Avid Conspiracy, and in essence, it was just talking about how much we contribute to other things, both time, energy, and money, in this season, versus that focus being on Christ. And so from that, we're going to build today and talk about the anticipation. How many of you know when your birthday is coming that you begin to at least get a little bit excited? And as time gets closer, you kind of clap, you kind of got a little hop in your step. It's like, it's my birthday. And so, it's no different as we talk about Christ. There were people anticipating his coming, and they were getting excited. But this wasn't no ordinary birth. In fact, this was the most radical, revolutionary birth ever to happen. There hasn't been one since, and there will not be. And so when we dive into Luke today, at this point, it's going to be about the conversation between two ladies. Two ladies who are with child. Now, if you've ever been around a person who is with child, you know you can get a mix of emotions. I'm just going to park that right there. You can get a variety of emotions and expressions. And so we're going to look at their, watch this, anticipation about our Lord and Savior. And let me give you this last backdrop before we read this out loud together. We're living in a chaotic world. We've got police indictments. We've got police shootings. We've got government that's seemingly unstable is an understatement of it. We've got challenges in our own communities, and some of us got challenges in our own families and neighborhoods. And in the middle of all of that comes Christmas. Can I tell you that's not coincidental? Because when Christ was born, the world was in chaos. And everybody was looking for someone to be a savior. And everybody had their own idea of what a savior should be. And in comes Jesus, totally different than what they expected, and yet he was everything we need. So that's our Savior. Luke writes, he's the only Gentile writer in the New Testament. He's a physician. He cares about the outcast, the poor, the widow, the fatherless. His heart is bent towards those who would normally be seen as outside of God's house. So I'm going to read these six verses for you. It says this. Now at this time, Mary arose and went in a hurry to the hill country to a city of Judah and entered the house of Zacharias and greeted Elizabeth. When Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. And she cried out with a loud voice and said, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. And how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord will come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, the baby leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there will be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord." You may have your seat. The anticipation. We find ourselves in this place with Elizabeth and Mary, two ladies, two esteemed ladies whom are known throughout the centuries for the babies that they carry. I want you to understand something very quickly. In this society and culture, for a woman not to have a baby meant that she was looked at as less than. And in Elizabeth's case, she had been barren for many years. She was an older woman with an older husband. And as they say, the years had gone by for what would have been known as the time to have a child. But the Lord comes to Zacharias while he's in the temple, serving his time in the temple, because he's out of a priestly family, a priesthood lineage, and talks to him about his wife having a child. And he doubted God, so God silenced him till his son was born, John the Baptist. The Bible says that Elizabeth went into isolation for 5 months. So when she comes out of isolation, she's headed into month 6. At the same time, the angel then visits Mary and talks to Mary about the fact that she would be with child. So you've got two kind of extremes. One, an older lady who had been barren, and one a younger lady that many suggest was in her teenage years, who had not been with a man, who was not yet married. She was engaged. Many scholars believe at this point, Joseph did not know that the angel had visited her to tell her that she would have a child. So you see the backdrop that's coming. You got an older lady now with child. You got a younger lady with child. You got one father who's been silenced by the Lord, which to me might have been a blessing, because then he couldn't say something silly while his wife was pregnant and get himself in trouble. Only dads can appreciate this statement. But then also, you've got a father out here who would be Jesus' earthly father, but not his real father, who does not know that his bride-to-be is with a child that he did not conceive. And so here we are. She hears God speak through this angel. The angel makes it clear. She hops up, and we see the journey. Verses 39 and 40 talk about her journey. Now, at this time, she arose, it says. Arose has the sense that it was quickly. In other words, she believed God. She didn't wait any longer. She didn't need to pray anymore. She believed God. She went to the place where Elizabeth was. It says the hill country of Judah. They believed this was about an 80 to 100 mile track. It would take 3 to 4 days, which would be not normal for a young lady, let alone a pregnant young lady, because in this day and age, it was known that people would sometimes sit along the roadside looking for people to rob, looking for people to wound, looking for people to hurt. So here are the circumstances. She is traveling down a road alone in the early stages of pregnancy to see her relative. The Bible does not say this was her cousin. We just kind of adopted that because that sounds good. Because in our culture, especially African Americans, everybody's a cousin. But the Bible does not tell us that. It just simply lets us know she goes to visit a relative. So she makes haste. She trusts God enough to travel alone to get to the place where her cousin was. And when she enters the place has the people. The people, the person rather, is Elizabeth. Elizabeth's name simply means that my God has been good to me. Zacharias' name, it says the house, because men in that day were seen as owners of everything. Zacharias' name means the Lord remembers me. So this is a family that's already celebrating something that God has done miraculously, and in walks Mary. And the Bible says in verse 40 that she greeted Elizabeth. Can I tell you that wasn't the type of greeting we have? Because especially if there's anybody in here with teenagers in your house, you know when they come in the house and you say hello to them, they kind of give you a head nod or throw a hand, and they go off to their room as if everything in the world is falling apart. They don't pay no bills. They don't go no grocery shopping. They get to pick out clothes, but yet their world is coming to an end. Wasn't that kind of grieving? This kind of greeting took time. It was a time of embracing, a time of possibly a kiss on the cheek. It was a time of intimacy and endearment. So it wasn't just a, hey, how you doing? It was a, sometimes how I see my wife and her friends when they come together, hey girl, how you doing? And they real loud. And I be wanting for them to go ahead and just say what they need to say and get on with it so I can get back to my peace and quiet. But then they spark a conversation, and I'm going, y'all talking about a lot of nothing. Can y'all just move that to another space? But no, they keep talking because they're happy to see one another. They catch up. That was a greeting in this day and age. It took time. It was not rushed. It was something that was important. It was something that was significant. So they greet each other well. They love on each other in Elizabeth's house, because could you imagine if you're married, you've been on the road 3 or 4 days, and by the way, wasn't no Ubers, wasn't no taxis, yeah, wasn't no rental cars, there were no airplanes. You either walked or rode on some kind of animal. Now let that sink in for a moment. For those of you who are ladies in the room, you with child and you traveling 3 or 4 days, watch this, and at best, you on an animal, and at worst, you walking. Now, how many of you know you like your family, but you wouldn't have seen Elizabeth that day? Because in your mind, you would have said, I like her, but that's 80 miles, that's 3 or 4 days. I got bags, because I need change of clothes. I got multiple shoes. I got stuff that I need to take with me. And you mean to tell me I ain't got no rental car? I can't hop on Groupon and find me a deal that will get me there. I've just got to deal with this and walk there. And I don't know how this gonna go because I'm early on in my pregnancy and I might get hungry, I might get nausea, and I gotta get there. But can I tell you what overrode all of that for Mary was the fact that she wanted to see what God had promised. He told her that not only would you be with child, but that your relative would be with child. Here's the sign I'm giving you. I'm not asking you that you need one. Rather, I'm going to give it to you to just show you how serious I am, that when I make a promise that I keep it. And so she hopped up and said, I got to get there. I got to see this for myself. So they're greeting, they're loving on each other. And then after they're loving on each other, that's the journey. Here comes the joy. Because in verse 41, it says, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, the baby leaped in her womb. The baby leaped. Now keep in mind, Elizabeth is an older lady who's pregnant. 6 months at this point. And a baby starts leaping. Brothers, I'm trying to help you out. Because the ladies in the room already understand the depth and the significance of this. At 6 months and she's up in age, you don't want anything inside of you leaping or moving or doing anything. You want it to be status quo and sit still. And the Bible says, but when Mary spoke, the baby in her leap, she's pregnant with John the Baptist. The Bible had promised he would come. He is the forerunner for Jesus. He is the precursor and the one preparing the way for people to receive him. And already, before he even comes out the womb, he's leading and prompting people, first his mother, to let her know who's in the house. He's already on assignment, even at birth, letting her know that Jesus is in the building. I can't see Jesus. I can't touch him. But let me tell you, when this woman opened up her mouth, I knew Jesus was in here, and it caused me to move around. When you are his and he is yours, something about you can't keep still when you know Jesus is moving in your life. There's something about him that will make you get up when you're tired, will make you talk to him when you don't feel like talking, will make you read a Bible when you say to yourself, I'm done with this. There's something about Jesus that just makes those of us who are his begin to move. So here it is, she begins to move. Rather, the baby in her begins to leap, begins to move. And the Bible says Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. That's significant right there, because we haven't even gotten to the point where Jesus has walked the earth and told the disciples over in John 16 that when he goes away to prepare a place for them, that he was going to send another one, a comforter, someone to keep them, the Holy Spirit, someone to guide them in his absence. Because he said, look, I can't leave you alone, because if I leave you alone, then you'll start doing stuff on your own and you'll get yourself into trouble. How many of you know you need a good guide? Because without a good guide, you can find yourself in places and in stuff and in things that you don't want to be in. So Jesus says, then I'm going to send you a helper. But Jesus has not even been born yet. But the Bible says that she was filled with the Holy Spirit. Matter of fact, in Luke 1:15, it says that John the Baptist, the baby, was filled with the Holy Spirit. The only baby to be born filled already before entering the earth. What does this mean? It simply says to us that there are times where God pulls out his spirit for special assignments. And this is a special assignment. She says to her in verse 42, blessed are you among women. You are blessed. You are blessed among women. It's a Jewish way of saying you are the most blessed among women. It is not to say that she's better than all women, but it is to say that she is a blessed woman, not because of who she is, but because of who she's carrying. It is to suggest, to say, that we should never worship Mary because Mary couldn't redeem us, but we do esteem her for the very fact she got the privilege to carry Christ. Could you imagine that for a moment? You pregnant with the Savior of the world. You talk about wanting to watch what you eat and watch what you drink and watch where you going, watch what you say. You talk about Jesus being with you. Jesus was really literally in her. Yeah, could you imagine when people pushed her button? She probably wanted to say something and then had to say, wait a minute, I got Jesus with me. And have people look at her crazy. What do you mean Jesus with me? No, he's growing on the inside of me. But Elizabeth says, you are blessed. Notice
even though Elizabeth was excited about what was happening in her life, she humbly submitted herself to Mary because she understood that what was going on with Mary was even far more greater. She teaches us what humility looks like, which means, watch this, I can celebrate what God is doing in your life because God can do something in your life and in your life and in my life all at the same time, and it doesn't take away from him being who he is or demean or take away from what he wants to do with me. Can I say it another way? There's no need for us to ever get jealous of anybody because God got enough to bless everybody. Amen. Can I say it like this? This was amazing to me was the fact that she could put aside in her own house and make room for the one who would be ruler over her house. She says, you are blessed. You are blessed, Mary. You are a young woman and you are blessed among all women. You are to be esteem. So that's the joy, the audio. They said it verbally. They weren't like us today. Because let's be real, there are times where we look at something and see somebody else with something, we go, well, what happened to me, God? And then here's the next step. We say stuff like, but God, I've been doing X. And I've been doing this. And I've been faithful over that. And you mean to tell me you're going to do that for them, but you can't do it for me? You really going to play me to get me to believe that you've never compared what God is doing in somebody else's life to your life and then said, God, have you checked my resume and seen all that I've been doing for you in the kingdom? And yet you seemingly just skip over me? Okay, I got 5 of y'all that was honest. Let's talk about the other 15 of y'all. Mary and Elizabeth show us what true relationship and anticipation with Jesus looks like because neither gets jealous about what God is doing in their life. In fact, they celebrate it in such a way that it, watch this, carries on throughout their lineages. So she says, you're blessed. You are favored among women. You are loved. But here's where it really gets exciting. She says at the end of verse 42, she says, blessed is the one in your womb. Now, how does she know who's in her womb except the Holy Spirit, God, revealed it to her? How does she know that Jesus is in the house except he be revealed to her? She says, you don't have to tell me, Mary, what God is doing in your life because God is revealing it to me. There's something about, here's where I'm going with it. When we are connected together, we can know what's happening in somebody else's life because God will reveal it. And when God begins to reveal what's going on in everybody's life, we should be the first ones to celebrate and congratulate instead of shut each other down. You really want to see a sad thing, the thing that bothers me the most today is the fact that Christians are the least likely to celebrate another Christian. If anything, we begin to compare marbles and then we want to highlight somebody else's sin as if we ain't got our own. But we put it on the rating scale. My sin is less than yours, so therefore I should be more blessed than you. But that's not how God works. When we are connected to him, we are called to celebrate together. So here's where it gets real sticky. Verse 43, it says this. We've heard about this journey, the joy that they got for each other. But here's the justification. Here it is. This is where it gets interesting. She says, and how has it happened to me that the mother of my Lord would come to me? She says, how is it that you thought enough of me to come to where I am? And not only come to me, but you the mother of my Lord. You are the mother of my Savior. Could you imagine? I keep stressing this because I want you to get the significance of the humility. These are adult women understanding that they're going to have to surrender to a baby that ain't even been born yet. Come here, parents. How many of you know you the first one to check your child and tell your child, look, I'm the king of this castle, and ain't nobody going to rule or do anything unless I say so. But here is it flipped on his head. They are prepared to submit to a child, a baby, that ain't been born yet. She says, how is it? In other words, she said, how did I get graced enough that Jesus would show up in my house and that his mama would come? My Lord, it doesn't say his name, but it's pointing to Jesus. So it asks the question, who is this Jesus? The Jesus we believe in is the Jesus who's existed always and always has been and always will be. John 1 and 1 says, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. Not anything was made, it made itself by God. That Jesus, the one that it says later on that he came and dwelled among us, that Jesus, the one who was there in the beginning when he said, let us make man. He was there. It was the Word, and he was the Word, and then he took on the flesh and was born. This is the Jesus she's talking about. But can I tell you why I'm highlighting that? Because I told you last week we were going to get into, everybody don't believe what we believe. So some people would tell you, I love God and I love Jesus, and they Jesus ain't your Jesus. Come here, Jehovah Witnesses. Have some in my family, love them dearly, but we strongly disagree. Can I tell you what a Jehovah Witness believes? They just believe Jesus was a man, that he was born and that he died, and that his spirit transcended his body. They don't believe in the Trinity at all. They believe in Jehovah, the one true God. They believe on 144,000 people made to heaven. The rest of us are stuck on earth for 1,000 years and have to live right. And if we don't live right, then God will annihilate us. They don't believe in a Lord and a Savior, a someone who came to redeem us. They just simply believe he was a man. He didn't die on a cross. He died on a stake. And when he died, he was dead. That's the Jesus they believe. This started in the 1800s by three different people. That's what Jehovah's Witnesses believe. When they knock on your door and give you their Watchtower pamphlet, they follow that more than they do the Bible. I give them credit for being devout and being devoted, but I have to highlight the fact that they've got it severely wrong, because if I'm left to my own demise and Jesus' blood wasn't enough to wash away my sins, then what do I have left? Where does my hope lie if there isn't someone who is greater than me that can redeem and save me? Because if I'm left to my own demise, on a good day, I'm corrupt. And on a bad day, I'm severely corrupt and bruised and damaged. And I need somebody who can step into my life and restore everything that's broken about me. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. So that's what they believe. But our friends, the Mormons, let me tell you what they believe. They believe Jesus is the creation of the Heavenly Father and a Heavenly Mother. They believe that God got with a woman and had a child and named him Jesus. They believe that God that we serve and worship was once on earth and he worked his way to become a God. Could you imagine that? If God just walked the earth and started here and came, well then who created everything that we see? And if he started off down here like me, how can he save me? Because he's just like. And not only do they believe that, they believe a man named Joseph came in the middle of the earth one day and had a vision, and that's how you got Mormonism, affectionately known as the Church of the Latter-day Saints. And this man came into the middle of the earth. Can I tell you what the middle of the earth is? Independence, Missouri. That is what they believe. And if you go around certain parts of Kansas City, they built temples where they've got steps leading up very high. They're very beautiful. They're very prestigious. They spent a lot of money because they believe at some point this man from heaven is going to come and walk through their temple, because they're in the middle. And that's where Joseph, the creator, had this vision. Yeah. Now, if you talk to them, they'll say, yeah, we love Jesus too. But can I tell you the Jesus they love ain't the Jesus you love? Because if Jesus is the Jesus that they say he is, that means he was born of a man and a woman, which is corrupt and full of sin. So how can you save me from something that you are just like me in? You don't have the power to do so. But I won't stop there. I'm going to give you one more today, and then I'm going to spare you to next week. Buddhism. They don't believe in a God at all. Matter of fact, what they believe is you live reincarnated enough times to where hopefully you can start down an eightfold path to where you become non-existent at all. The whole idea of their life is to reach nirvana, is to become where nothing in life ever affects you ever. And they believe you can follow 8 simple steps over time to where you can get to a point where nothing in life impacts you. The first thing I'm going to ask them, well, then talk to me, when somebody catch cancer or have a heart attack or have a loved one that they love get shot down and killed, how does that not impact you. Talk to me when you just go to work and you show up and they shut work down and now you no longer have a job and you are without money. Tell me what 8 steps can I follow so that that don't impact me. Tell me what do I do when somebody I love is facing an illness that they can't shake and I have to watch them die. How does that not impact me? And how do I ever grow to a point where I'm non-existent? But can I tell you, not only do they not believe in God, there is no Jesus in historical Buddhism. In modern day Buddhism, in the West, they believe he was an enlightened teacher. No savior, just an enlightened human being. And in other parts of the world, they believe he was what's called an avatar, meaning a manifestation of a God. But he wasn't fully God and fully man. Others believe not only was he dead, but he was a person who worked himself up to become like a God. Pastor, why are you going through all this? Because you're going to meet people in this season. You're going to walk past people in the store. You're going to have people say, Merry Christmas to you. And I can tell you when they saying it, it ain't the same thing as what you're saying. But can I tell you the one distinctive that I love about Christianity and what I believe and makes everything come together is the fact that it speaks to how we got in all this trouble when it's the fall, when sin entered in the world. And it tells us in Genesis 3:15 that there would be one who would come who would redeem us from all of our sins and restore us and prepare a place for us to live. There was one who was greater than us, who is greater than us, who lives in heaven, who watches over us, who keeps us, who prays for us, who watches over us, who protects us when we can't protect ourselves. There is one whose blood was righteous enough, whose love ran deep enough, who was patient enough to hang on a cross just so he could resurrect in the third day to overcome all of this earth's madness. That's why I love Jesus, because there's enough in him to conquer everything that this earth would ever throw at us, because he that is greater than us, that is in us, is not in this world. That's why they celebrated in Mary and Elizabeth's house. Because Jesus is revolutionary. He ain't just this nice, kind guy sometimes that we make him out to be that came and walked the earth and went back to heaven. He was radical. He upset people. Why? Because certain people had systems going and he disrupted them. You had people who were making money off of folks paying for different things to try and buy their way to be with the Lord. Jesus is coming, he disrupts stuff. And because he disrupts stuff like political systems and economic systems, he was hated by many and they sought to kill him, not knowing that killing him was part of his whole plan, was to die in the first place. Just so he could save us. So that's the Lord that Elizabeth is talking about. That's why she gets happy, because she says, there's one coming that is greater than us, that can handle anything that we throw at him. There's one who's coming who will understand us, but yet not be like us. He will be tempted in all ways, but yet be without sin. There's one coming who can handle all of our issues and still love us in the midst of our issues. There's one coming who's going to take care of us in a way that we could never take care of ourselves. There's one coming that chapter 12 of Hebrews talked about the heroes and heroines of faith that they were waiting on but never saw him. We've not yet seen him, but we feel his presence, because how do you think you got up this morning? It wasn't your alarm clock. It wasn't your neighbor next to you. It was the Lord who touched you. How do you think some of you survived what you survived? Car accidents, sickness, gunshots, all kind of crime. You made it this far. Who do you think watched over you when you were foolish and doing stuff you didn't have no business doing? Who do you think loved you when nobody else wanted to touch you? Who do you think cared for you when nobody else could be found to put an arm around you? His name, as they used to make us say in Sunday school, they made us spell it J-E-S-U-S.
Yes.
Jesus Elizabeth is talking about. That's what made her womb leap. She says, verse 44, that's his identity. Here's the confirmation, Mary.
For behold, when the sound of your greeting reached my ears, a baby leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what had been spoken to her by the Lord. Can I tell you, the most difficult part for us in our humanity is that when something is said to us, we want immediate, not only confirmation, but gratification. Here's what I mean. If I tell you that I'm going to give you $10, my words sound good. But you ain't going to believe me till I put that $10 in your hand. I can pull it out. I can hold it up. I can show it to you. But some of you gonna quote to me our state slogan. This is the show me state. And until you put it in my hands, it's not true. What she was saying to Mary was, blessed that you follow what God said without even seeing it come to fruition yet. Here's a lesson in faith, and I'm done. Faith is not about what we can accumulate. It's about what we can affirm and follow without even seeing it, but still believe it. Can I tell you what makes this thing difficult? What makes Christianity difficult? Because there is an element of faith. The Bible says we walk by faith and not by sight, which means we walk with our details. We walk with people thinking something's wrong with us. We walk when we don't want to walk because we believe that in the end, what God says is true. One pastor I've listened to that I like what he had to say, his name is Pastor Wilfredo. He's in New Life Covenant Church in Chicago. He says this, understanding can wait, but obedience cannot. Can I tell you what makes that hard? Because the first time I ask you to do something, typically the first thing you're going to ask me is, how do I do it? Or we say something like, I need some clarification. Can you help me? And if we want to sound real nice, that's when we go with, I really want to understand. Could you help me understand and answer my questions? But can I tell you, with God, oftentimes there is no time to get an understanding. We just got to be obedient and follow. Can I tell you what makes that hard? It's because I want to know the outcome before I get the outcome. I want to know that if I do what you're asking me, that it's going to turn out the way you said. And I want to have a picture of that in my mind in advance before I get there. But here's the blessing for Mary. Mary didn't wait. When the Lord spoke to her about having a baby, she got up and saw the sign of her relative with a baby because she believed him. So here's something I want you to go home with. I want you to send you home thinking today. What do you believe? Do you believe that what God has said is true about who we are, about who he is? If not, this is a good time to start wrestling. Because most of us are okay if it's God's going to provide for me a job, God's going to provide for me a house, God's going to make sure I eat, God's going to take care of me. Those are all good, because those are all comfortable. But if God comes along and says, I want you to give all of that up and start this anew over here. I want you to leave your job. I want you to quit and go start this over here. Most of us are going to say, hold up, God. I got some questions. My mortgage due on the 5th. My car note due on the 7th. We typically go grocery shopping every other week, Lord, on Friday. How are we going to eat? Oh, by the way, Spire and American Water and MSD and Ameren, they all coming around the same time. And I can't tell them I'm going to pay that bill by faith. They want it by cash. So how does this work? And God is saying, trust him. Why am I going to this extreme?
Because there are some of us in here that I believe that just like Mary moved in trust, anticipating what God would do, in her case, the birth of Jesus, there's something that the Lord is trying to birth in some of us in here. And yet, the matter of it is, how much do we trust him to do? I'm going to leave you with this. When God started talking to me about a church, I was like, I'm good. I got 2 degrees. I make nice money. I can travel when I want to. I can buy what I want to. I said, God, church people are filthy. If they don't like something, if they don't give, then what I'm going to do? Go home and say, well, you know, the Lord giveth and the Lord taketh away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. That don't go over for a newlywed husband. I'm good. You fast forward several years down the road. He keeps talking about it. This is something he wanted to do. I'm still saying, God, I'm good. I done picked up another degree. Now I got 3 of them. Mm-mm. Okay, no problem. Job gets crazy. Boss comes in, says, we're eliminating your role. Have a nice life. Well, now I ain't got nothing but time. Called up a pastor friend and said, look, I believe this is what God is trying to do. I told him, I said, I'm going to be honest because we friends. Even though I sense God doing this, I'm sending like 100 resumes out a day. I'm on the internet, I didn't care what the job was. In my mind, I was qualified. I just needed a job. So I'm hitting enter to everything. He asked me, do you even read the job description? Nope. We sat down, we started talking. Went in his office, he had a whiteboard. We started mapping stuff out and started talking and kept praying. And I'm watching God provide from different resources and sources and people that I never thought that he would, and to the point where he eventually, I got into another job only for a short while, but he had put all of this together. What am I saying? I'm saying that to truly walk by faith and not by sight, I'm going to tell you what most times we don't say in church. It's risky. It's scary. It's frightening. It's frustrating. It's weight. It causes what I call pinch points in life where the stress gets so high because you're right at that point where you're like, if God don't come through, then stuff gonna be shut off. And this process and journey for me, we had a particular truck at the time, and I sensed God said, just give it back. I'm like, no, I ain't giving up my truck, no. I'm literally like a little kid, shaking my head, mm-mm. In my mind, I had worked too hard, made too much. No, 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 no. And then God asked me a simple question. If you trust me by faith, what does it matter if you lose? Is it the only one on earth? Can you get another one? If you lose your house, can you get another one? If you lose what you think you can't live without, do you believe that I can provide it again? Or is the truth of the matter that the stuff is your God? I wept. Because I wanted to be a good Christian and say, no, I can lose it all. But the reality of it, I was saying, God, don't take it. But here's what I learned. He can pry your fingers away from stuff that you think you cannot live without. That's what it made it easy for Mary to be able to go to Elizabeth's house without a baggage check claim and all the other things that typically we look to need, because she believed that God was able to preserve and take care of her. I don't know who I'm talking to this morning. But if you're going to be who he called you to be, and I believe he wants it for your life, you have to be willing to trust and know that he can provide whatever it is right at the moment that is needed.
next week we'll get into the song Mary wrote as a result of hearing the confirmation and trusting God. And she wrote the song before Jesus was ever born. That's what makes her story and the birth of Christ so amazing. She trusted God in such a way that she prepared life as if it was already done. If you got somebody next to you, take their hand. We're going to pray. Father, for many of us, the level of trust that you're calling us to is not like anything we've ever known. And just as Mary anticipated the birth of Jesus, and just as Elizabeth confirmed it for her, there was still a process of waiting, of trusting, of believing that Jesus is who he says he is, and that you are, Father, who you say you are. Help us to trust you today in that way. Help us in this season to anticipate and be reminded of that you are still the God who performs miracles, and that, Lord, you are still Lord and sovereign, and that we should celebrate you just for who you are and for all that you've done. May we keep you at the center of things in this season. May we stay focused on you in the midst of life's trials and heartaches and hardships. And may we trust you when we can't trace you. May we lay claim to your promises, even though we can't lay hands on the thing or the position or the place that you promised. Most of all, Lord, may we not lose sight of who you are. Therefore, empower us to love others in this season, just as you have loved us. And when we come out or walk in or receive or accomplish whatever it is you called us to do, we'll give you thanks and we'll give you credit, for we'll know that it is you that has done it. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Let us all stand together and say, amen.
Amen.
Let's put our hands together real quick. Let's stay on our feet. Let's get ready. If you have one already, on that back table, we have a whole another stack of these. Siri wants to worship too, I guess. We have a whole lot of these back there. Take one. It walks through different religions. It starts with Christianity and what we believe, and it walks through other religions and what they teach. Tell you why we're beating this drum so hard. Because not only in this season of Christmas, but going forward, it helps to know that we have someone walking with us who keeps us angry in mind. And sometimes I think we get moving so much that we forget the significance of what it means for Jesus to have lived and died and rose to save us from ourselves. And so if you have time, grab one. Here's the only other announcement I have for today. Actually, two. There's something else I want you to grab. Back there, there's an admin reading list. If you're a person who just likes to get up and read scripture in the morning or read it late at night, but you wonder or think about what should I read, in this season, there's each day on here just a short passage that you can read, meditate on, that will keep you focused on what this season is really about. I stress this because in a minute I know what's going to happen. In about another week and a half, kids going to be out of school. They're going to be in your house eating up all your food. They're going to be running around, and you're going to be finalizing plans for family to come over or for you to go to family. And all of that is great stuff. Hear me. I'm not anti any of that. What I am saying is, it's real easy for Jesus to be in the backdrop of that
and lose sight of him while all this other stuff is going on. So if you're a planner, as I am a planner, put this in your Rolodex. Just pick one up and let it have an alarm and go off, and you can say, oh, there's nothing wrong with planning and reading scripture. God ain't offended by that. It just breaks his heart when we don't go to it at all. So please utilize it. Here's the third and last thing for today. We've got new t-shirts in, short and long, like this one. The long sleeve t-shirts are $12. The other ones are $10. They're nice quality. Every Sunday going forward after church, if you want one, you can go to the lower level and you can buy one. You can write a check or you can give cash. Reason being, we apologize, it took so long. Several of you had asked in the past, but we don't get any more. And let's just say sometimes it's hard to find the right vendor to do what you want done at the quality level you want it at. We kept going back saying that color ain't the color of our logo. That ain't gonna work. It could be just a little bit. But seriously, those are there. So, you've got that. I've announced the other two things. So here's how we're gonna leave. We're gonna give offering. We're gonna greet one another. For those of you who are guests today, thank you so much for being here. We love seeing your face. We wanna see it again and again and again. You'll get sucked in real quick. It's real easy to happen. So, find not only somebody you don't know and somebody you didn't ride with, but somebody you really don't know that much about. And just say hello to them this morning. Why? Because all of us have life happening right now, and you never know. Your smile may be the one thing that make a person think, okay, I can make it for another day. But some of us are living for weeks, and some of us are just trying to make it day to day. So can we handle that? All right, on the count of three, one, two, three. Have at it. God bless you. Enjoy the rest.
God bless you.